Tsavo County, and that is Mheshimiwa Francis Kimemia. Your Excellency, thank you for joining us this evening.
Thank you.
Let's start with the first peer-to-peer governors meeting, which has taken place. Yes. Possibly what you've learned from it.
There are several lessons that we have learned, and I particularly have learned from it. And number one is the need to demystify what the governor does and working with the people, right from the village. And of course, what we are calling existential engagement of the people, not just involvement, but engagement of the people on real time. And we're involving them now, not just before then we used to involve them in the implementation of projects, but even in the inception, in the conceptualization of the projects that they require based on their needs, then into designing those projects, designing with them, then of course, budgeting with them, if there are policy or laws that are to be developed, doing it with them, all the way to implementation and monitoring and evaluation, and very fundamentally, involving them in the monitoring of the contracts, how the contractors are implementing those projects.
Okay.
That you disclose, for instance, how many lorries of stones will be on this road, and then Wananchi keep count, you know, with the project management committees at the village level. I think those are very, for us who are new governors, that's a very, very important aspect in governance.
Okay, and obviously by virtue of public participation, from what you've mentioned, there's an element of cost saving.
Yes, a lot of cost savings. If you look at, for instance, the hospital that we went to, costing 125 million, including equipments. I can assure you, if those projects, those type of projects, the ones I've seen, are moving into 1 billion shillings. So I think involving the Wananchi gives better value for money. And of course, the other thing that we want to address now with the national government is this question of public works, the quantity surveyors in government. I think those are the worst sources of inflation, over-inflation of projects in the counties.
Okay.
Because once they come up with the estimates, and the contractors know that this is what this project is estimated to cost, half a billion shillings, yet it costs 100 million shillings. Then the governor is left at the mercy of, you know, the vagaries of contractors.
Mm-hmm.
But we're also getting, what I realized in Makueni, they also hire private QSs to come and also give independent assessment of the project.
Which keeps the costs down.
Then you're able to query the government QSs who are fond of inflating costs of projects.
Right.
I think that's a very important
issue. Do you have structures in Nyandarua where you have public participation like you've seen here?
Yes, we have a very, 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 very aggressive and very involving public participation. We have completed our CIDP, and it was very extremely, extremely involving. We had Wananchi saying what they want per village. This is what we want. This is the way we want it done. And of course, it was very clear that the Wananchi were not very happy with those who are supposed to be doing oversight getting involved in implementation. So Wananchi want to now take over the oversight role. And I think going forward, what we'll do is to ensure that the assembly oversights projects that I do, also get Wananchi also to oversight projects together with the MCAs.
Okay.
Then that puts ministers also on check. And so that even if I don't visit those projects, maybe sometimes you're unable to go there when the project is possibly 50-60% to completion, then at least you have people who are supervising it for them, I mean for you as a governor.
Okay.
You have a management team that is managing. We want to introduce a dashboard. I didn't see it in Makueni here, but we want to introduce a dashboard. Start from my office. At least you can also be able to check what is happening through the continual feeding mechanisms on the ground.
And how would that dashboard work?
At least all the projects are keyed in, and you can be able to. We are working with a team that is using drones. That you can send a drone to a certain road, and he's able to take photographs and feed into the governor's dashboard. So you can see real time what is actually happening on the ground. The way President Kagame is distributing drugs using drones. I think it's high time we also leverage technology. That as a governor, you can send in a drone to load A to B, and it's able to take a pictorial view, and you're able to see whether what you are being told in the office is correct or not. And maybe some of the drones can be able to even give you measurements. This road is 15 meters wide, it's so much long. So whatever you're being told in the office is not is not
you
an
can
issue.
Verify.
You can verify
you
even
can
through,
verify it real
through
time.
Technology. Yeah, real time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, what are there any sub projects that you can say in Nyandarua County that have actually come up because of public participation? They've literally been brought up by the people, not just because the government feels
yes.
that that's what they need.
Yes, I can give two examples. One of them is the youth empowerment program, where the youth came and told us, we can stop drinking, but give us something to do. Mm. And then we asked them, what can we do? And they said, we can organize cooperatives, register us into companies, which we need as a county, buy us machines to do car washing, to make culverts, to make clothes, you know, the sewing machines. Some girls, some of the ladies, we have rehabilitated, you know, able to pick on the hair, you know, what you call the hair, you know, dryers, those who do saloons and so on. And many, many, the barbers, all those youth engagement programs, the ones who are mechanics, got machines for doing mechanics. Mm-hmm. And now, today, we have youths getting 8,000 shillings a day through those businesses.
Through those businesses.
Through those businesses. Mm-hmm. Number two, the Okalau town. Mm-hmm. The businessman told me the town is too dirty, it's too dusty, it's too muddy. Can you please pave the town for us, put cabro. And we've done that. I think you've just been saying we have almost done a kilometer of a cabro works. Some of them, you can see them in my Facebook. Mm-hmm. And this is from the people themselves. And they are working with the contractors. Mm-hmm. And the young people are the ones who are actually undertaking those works. The works, the youths who are in local town.
Okay.
And now they have started getting businesses. Ultimately, I want them to get a kilometer also, the youths. Get them, I hire machines for them, get engineers for them, some of those jobless engineers in the county, get one from the public works, my public works office in the county, and get the youths also take that contract. And we start creating entrepreneurs from youths who are almost becoming hopeless mm-hmm. in the county, because I was elected on the theme of hope, mm-hmm. that we can bring hope to everybody in the county.
In the county. All right, now we've seen in
and of course the
county,
potato processing plant, mm-hmm. we are doing the potato processing plant very soon. That is almost
actually that was my next question, because yes. Nyandarua is well known for potatoes.
Yes, we are the lead producers of potatoes.
Exactly,
we produce 35% mm-hmm. of the national potato, which is the second now most important crop mm-hmm. in the national food value chain.
So has anything been done in regards to now making sure that farmers are getting a maximum output? For instance, if I use Wate as an example,
yes.
They've talked about mangoes, which
yes.
they produce. And from where they were selling a mango at roughly 5 shillings per mango,
yes.
now they're selling mangoes at 15 shillings per kilo, which is value add.
Yes, it's
value. But
yes.
we can also see progress in terms of now the pulp that they make. That is something that youth can take up and also sell. What are you doing with potatoes?
With potatoes, we have already come up with designs for a potato processing plant. We are beginning with the help of the European Union and the Irish government. We are coming up with better seeds. You see, in potatoes, you have to really come up with very good seeds which are disease-free, seeds that are best for whatever use. If you want chips, the chips that are, the potatoes, that the varieties that are best for chips. Mm-hmm. So we don't have to import now chips from South Africa and Egypt, because we can grow them. We can contract farmers in the county, and that's what we are now doing, enumerating the farmers. We're already doing tissue culture laboratory. It's being done in Ojorok. In Nyandarua County, mm-hmm. and we have already begun with the national government to do feasibility studies to establish cold storage and also one processing plant, and then secondly revive the machine in Jabini, mm-hmm. Midrand factory to start processing, although it's private sector owned, but we want to see whether farmers can also buy into shares. And then if we have two potato processing machines, we can produce starch, we can produce chips, we can produce unga flour, which you can possibly exchange with countries like this, because that would be long-lasting. Mm. And then, of course, you control the market. In the value chain, you control how you harvest potatoes once, and then they're finished. So the prices are so low, because there's no storage. I mean, the post-harvest losses are too much. So we want to contain that through cold storage, and then you can release them to the market as you wish. Mm. And so I think the potato market in Nairobi should be Nyandarua, mm-hmm. and we want to locate it somewhere in Magumu, just within the county. Come up with cold storage, and you can feed Uganda, you can feed Rwanda, you can feed Congo from the, you know, so where Sokompia, Sokomjinga, mm-hmm. Sokompia. That's why we want to put up an international potato market and also research mm-hmm. For potatoes.
Okay.
Because we are leading that will be the next crop that people will be really depend on for food security.
Now, are there systems that you have found in place as a first-time governor? There was a predecessor who was there. And what challenges have you found possibly fitting into that position, and you have to now carve a direction for the county?
Yes, I think the worst challenges that I found are very, very poor. One, very poor strategies, or almost none at all. Very, very weak structures, very weak systems, and very weak human resource capacities. Whether you're talking about staffing, the levels of staffing, the skilling levels, even the styles, what you call the styles of management, and almost no value system, shared core value system, no teamwork. So we found almost a very disjointed.
So have you had to begin like from ground zero?
We're almost beginning from ground zero. Mm-hmm. And it has been very, we spent almost the first 7 months trying to construct a government. Mm-hmm. So it was like an absentee management system that worked there. And it is, you can see it, really, it has really bogged our time. But I can assure you there are systems that are learning. We have problems with the Public Service Board, which was almost handpicked by the former regime, and sometimes used to frustrate you. Try to recruit chief officers, and you find yourself being given people you don't want, or people who have issues, ethical issues, with the ESCC. The people you have been given are the ministers you rejected to become your chief officers for finance. Mm-hmm. So to more or less frustrate you. So those are some of the things that have really
teething problems.
Dragged some of the governors, first-time governors in the counties. But I think what we have also learned today is the issue of patience. Some of the projects we have seen here began in 2016. So if once you work with people, then it is possible that even if those projects are not complete, either for due to financial reasons, when your time comes, it is possible if people see that you are transparent and you are accountable, mm-hmm. that people allow you to complete those projects. So I think it would be very good that Governor Kibwana was retained and is able now to complete that hospital.
To complete the hospital.
Able to equip it. Mm-hmm. The dam has been finished. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure the other projects that are, because we must add value to the lives of people. I think a governor must add value to the people. And you must make people realize what they could not realize if you're not the governor.
Okay. And you have now 4 years to go in this particular term. What is the one thing that you'd want the people of Nyandarua to know that you're going to fulfill for them?
I think one thing I must guarantee the people of Nyandarua is that one is the potato issue. That is very dear to the lives of the
Nyandarua. That's their livelihood.
Yes, because that's what they sell. And there is no value at all. You cannot educate your children. You can't go to a good hospital. You can't go to a good school. You can't take your kids to university. You can't even eat well. You can't dress well. You can't build a good house. But every morning you're in the shamba, in the land, tilling land, like a slave. But there's nothing that comes in to the people of Nyandarua. Then the road network. The roads are very, very poorly done. And this is why we found ourselves also involving the youth to produce culverts, because it rains too much in Nyandarua. So if the roads are not properly coverted, then those roads never last. This time, all the roads were washed away. So we want to come up with a system where roads can last at least, up to 10 years. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then you just maintain them. So roads is something that we would like to make sure that every part of Nyandarua, farmers can access markets and they can move. Even if they're not tarmac, mm-hmm. at least they can be able to move the goods. Then the issue of water. We are only 30% coverage in Nyandarua County. We want to make sure at least within a kilometer or two, anybody can walk, the farthest you can walk, is 2 kilometers to get water. But I want to make it 1 kilometer. We have done very many boreholes since we entered office, and we are now starting to desilt.
To desilt the dams. A time frame for that, because there are promises that are made by many leaders and governors, but fruition becomes a problem. Do we have a time frame?
These are things we can do. Because we have water in the county, and constructing boreholes with our own machines is just costing about 2 million shillings. So these are things that we can do because we've already done the mapping. Mm-hmm. of the area, so it's very easy to achieve these targets. Mm-hmm. And of course the issue of the electricity, we want at least to make sure at least 50% of the homes now have power.
Okay.
I know the targets in the national government is 70%, but with I as a governor, because we've already started budgeting for transformers, we want to make sure at least 50% of our homes have power.
Okay. There's also the question that came up in Makueni, and this is the cost of a dam at seven million shillings,
yeah,
which most of the governors were surprised because it's quite reasonable. We'd have expected it to cost money. In Nyandarua, what systems have you put in place to ensure that money is not pilfered?
We want the issue of pre-evaluation of the projects we want to implement. It is possible because there are two modalities that we use in Nyandarua. Either you do the contracts, or we hire government machines from the Ministry of Public Works or from NOIS, and then you own a fuel. You pay the government valuation, I mean the government renting costs, and then you just fuel, and you make sure that the officers are able to make sure that those machines give you best value for money.
Mm.
Loads that we are costing 2 million shillings, I'm only spending less than 100,000 shillings just to grade a load using the government bulldozers. You can do 30 kilometers with just about one tank or two tanks of diesel. So it becomes very, very cheap if it is government to government. And that's what has been done in this dam, because they hired government machinery and they just fueled and they were able to scoop. And that is the model. That's the model I want to use, utilizing in Nyandarua County.
Okay, now
it is doable. But you see the attraction of the contractor is that possible they'll give you 10% so you have something in the pocket. But if you're leading for the one inch to get value for their monies that are being given to the county, I think that is the route to take.
Mm.
Because there are so many machines in government, get them for poor counties like in Nyandarua, Makueni, that would be the best route to use.
Mm-hmm.
Get government machines, just put in diesel, let one inch get services. Later on you can bring in contractors, but do a hybrid so that you also don't starve the local contractors in the county, and they don't see you as an enemy who came to finish up
their business.
But you have to mix up because one inch want services. In Nyandarua, there are places you cannot access to date because there are no roads at all. You can't even take your vehicle to those locations.
Mm-hmm.
You know, places like Gashua in Kipipiri.
And those are high producing areas.
And they are very, very fertile soils.
Mm.
So we have to make sure we have those machines from government, open up those roads, try to, as much as possible, moram those roads. And then later on, you can use the private sector to go into other softer areas.
Mm-hmm.
But at least open up the county for everybody to access markets.
Okay. Now you had worked at the national.
I don't want to forget
level.
The milk.
Yes.
I don't like to forget the issue of milk in Nyandarua County. It's an issue. If God, you know, resources allowing and God willing, we would like to also see potatoes and milk. Those are things I want to carry on.
Mm.
Some of the monies that I got when the county became number two with the World Bank, we got about 300 million shillings, 283 million. We want to start the potato processing plant with that money.
Mm.
Next year, I'm sure we'll also get more money, so we want to move into milk. So if I do milk and potatoes, at least in my first time, I'll have been able to at least assist
the people
of Nyandarua to do something. And in the budget, we have 1 million shillings, had 1 million shillings.
Mm.
So if you had 1 million shillings, then the 285, almost half a billion shillings, that should be enough.
Mm.
We can allocate half a billion shillings, we can start a factory, a potato processing factory.
Okay.
In Nyandarua County.
You have worked for the national government at the national government level for a long time. What experience do you say you bring on board, and especially knowing the challenges that national government has, especially relating to the local government, this being, the second term, would say, in terms of devolution being put in place?
I think what I said is very important. You see, government is about order. And it's about predictability, service predictability, coming up with good structures in government, good systems that work, systems that enhance accountability in the management of resources, in giving results to people, coming up with service charters that are able to deliver results to people, and holding every public servant accountable through the performance contract, which I introduced in my ministry. I think that was the first ministry to introduce performance contracting in government. I think these are some of the things that we want to make sure that the focus in the counties, even by MCS, is service delivery, not politicking, not 2022. We should focus on giving people services as a right. Well, that is a right to get. If you remember that motto, Huduma Bora ni Haki ya Kila Mwananchi, it was started by my ministry, provincial administration and internal security, because then we had a very, very bad name, and we were able to come out of that bad name and focus on services to the people. I think if there's anything I bring to the county of Nyandarua or to county governments, it's coming up with a culture of good governance in the counties.
All right.
And when you go to a public office, you must be able to know this is a public service, there is order, there is discipline, officers are working, courteously to serve wananchi, there are service charters, there are service registers. You're able to keep registers of people who come to, particularly the sub-counties. We're introducing service registers with our ward administrators to make sure anybody who comes for services, they record those services that are given to wananchi. And then I'm able to keep track of those people. My number is accessible to any wananchi in the county. Even if I don't answer it, we'll call them back.
At some point, we'll get back to them.
We'll get back to them.
All right, we're about to wind up, but I'd like to also just know, behind, you know, the governor and the title that the governor has, what does Honorable Kimemia do, you know, just to relax?
Well, I do farming. I've always done farming in my career. I'm a very, I enjoy reading and writing. We've just promised that we're also going to, I've not produced any book, but I've written several manuscripts, which I would like to start now publishing. If you remember something like the transition we did in 2013, amidst a very acrimonious political dichotomies that were there. I think it's the high time we came up with experiences in managing the, you know, the organized criminal gangs that really bedeviled our time, and we were able to stem that culture down and bring rule of law into shape, bring order into government, the performance management culture. These are things that I like leading. I do a lot of leading privately, but I also do a lot of farming.
Okay.
So these are things that we do off the governor's work.
All right. And from your experience, of course, having worked with different regimes and worked in different positions, what do you think is the challenge that Kenya has now that you're in politics? We have a very divisive style of politics, which is very tribal. What is our problem, and how do we resolve that?
I think we have to solve it as a country first. Once we are through with the war of corruption, and this issue of tribalism, I think we have to relook into a structure of government, national government, and see whether there are things we did not do right, whether it is possible to devolve power also to more echelons in society.
So would you recommend a parliamentary system as opposed to winner takes it all?
Because when we constructed it, we said it was not cast in stone, and there are very many glaring issues that we didn't finalize when we did it in 2010. I was still a champion of that constitution from where I was. But I think whether we agree on a parliamentary system or a hybrid system, that should be the business of all Kenyans, to see how do we share power in this country. And you see, power is seen relative to tribes, and you cannot get that out of the Kenyans in the next 10 years.
Okay.
So we need to come up with a robust system where power is seen to be shared across various offices, and it's not a monopoly of one or two individuals. I think that is what seems to be.
Do you see that changing? Because even as the Constitution is right now, it gives room for inclusion, it gives room for equality, but we still seem to have problems as a Kenyan, as Kenyans.
Yes, the ultimate solution would be to freely devolve resources to the counties.
To the counties.
So that the center is left to manage policies, to look at major legislations, but the management of resources is devolved to the county governments. So that every community, and that's why you need to also look at the formula of sharing resources, every community feels that they have been able to get their resources on an equitable basis. And then the center is left maybe to manage those national issues of national interest, whether disasters or the major programs. And again, they also, since parliament is also a house of the people, then at least they're able to make sure that there is equitability when it comes to major infrastructure that maybe need to be developed in the country. But as of now, people feel the constitution doesn't allow that flexibility in the sharing of resources in this country.
Okay, as one of those who are behind and anchored in reviewing of making of the constitution.
Yes.
Are you happy with where we are as a country, or had you envisaged that would be farther than we are right now?
I think we have done very well. We have done very well, particularly.
It has been called an ambitious.
Yes, it's very ambitious. It was actually a revolution. It was a revolution that was implemented without really bloodshed or any major chaos in the country. I think we need to credit Kenyans for that. Now you see, Kenyans can do very major things when they want to do major things. So I don't see any challenges in terms of revisiting that constitution and making sure that at least the interests of the people are catered for in that constitution, so that where there are gaps, those gaps are addressed. So I think I don't see any problem in terms of us being able to reform that constitution further, and that should be done continuously. Those of us who are boundary disputes, for instance, we'll soon be going to the border review mechanisms to see how towns like Nyahururu, that were stolen from Nyandarua County, can be returned.
How are you going to resolve the disunity between Nyandarua and Nyahururu County?
And Laikipia County.
Yes.
No, you see the historic injustice of transferring a whole area that belongs to Nyandarua to another county during the politics of the provinces. I think that it is possible to do it now, because discussing with the governor for Laikipia and ourselves and the two peoples, we should be able to come to a compromise. I don't think it's a major issue with the
country. So that's something you plan to resolve?
It's something that we are in discussion with the governor, and we also want to go to the intergovernmental committee and see whether they can facilitate a discussion on that issue.
Okay. Maybe as we close, your encouragement or final word to Kenyans, number one, and two, to the youth of this country.
I think to the youth, let me start with the youth, is to assure them that as governors, all of us have agreed to mainstream youth agenda in every ministry, so that every minister in the devolution, and I'm sure it will be the same thing with the national government, and we have impressed this on our president, that we make sure that every minister, whether national government or county government, mainstreams youth issues in their departments. So whether you're talking about agriculture, those programs that can be undertaken by the young people, let's involve them as much as possible. Let's hire those youths who are always seen in the shopping centers, graduates, people with masters and postgraduate qualifications. Let's involve them in management of the public affairs. Let's bring them back, bring them into government. Let's create companies, private companies for them, since we can't employ all of them. Let's see what they can best do and get them doing it. When we start the potato, for instance, the potato processing plant, what is it that the youth can do? And there are very many things that the youth can do, whether from Tekenyo side, labor side, and many, many other issues. The byproducts, you're working with the byproducts, the cottage industries. These are all youth. And by youth, I'm talking about somebody up to 40 years. I know we say 35 years. Yeah. So even up to 40, these are very young people. So we need to also expand who we call youth. So that we don't get demystified by the issue of 35. In the county, we have come up with a main fund, at least to counter the issue of youth fund, which goes only up to 35. So we have come up with a main fund, so those after 36 can then also benefit in the country, get some money, start companies, and start producing, but that's when your children go to high school. So you need money more than the money that we have available to the young people.
Absolutely.
Yes.
All right, you're parting short, and possibly just speak to the people of Nyandarua and what they should expect.
Yeah, I also want to assure the people of Kenya that we also want to stand for one nation and one people. This country belongs to us. We have borrowed it from our grandchildren, and that's why we must manage our country well, manage our environment well, manage our waters, manage our ecosystems well, manage our climates. I think we need to take care of our country and keep it clean and keep it secure. So this is what I'd like to appeal to the people of this country, to give us new governors a chance to at least to make a difference. I would like to make a difference in my county and make sure that the people of Nyandarua are never again going to be called marginalized. Whatever the historic injustices or situations they have gone through, I would like to see the people of Nyandarua shining as the next county in terms of moving forward, in terms of creating employment and creating prosperity for the entire people of Nyandarua County.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency.
Thank you very much.
Governor Francis Kimemia, Governor for Nyandarua County. Thank you for joining us this morning.
Asante.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.